our processional hymn, I Am the Way, King of the Victory. Historic Christchurch Chapel in the St. Thomas, St. John District Circuit. Let us worship God. Our choir, combined circuit choir, will now lead us in the choral introit. It is number 255 in our Voices in Praise. Praise him, Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, his wonderful love proclaim.
Thank you.
as we go to God in prayer. Let us all pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The commandments of our Lord Jesus. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline us to keep this law.
The second is this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and incline us to keep this law.
And a new commandment I give you, that you love one another even as I have loved you, that you also love one another.
Lord, have mercy upon us, and Christ, holy is your Lord in us. Bring this to you.
Let us now then in silence confess our sins to God and pray for his forgiveness. We pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against each other in thought and word and deed, in the evil we have done, and in the good we have not done, through ignorance, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all of our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in the newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear then the good news. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Amen. Thanks be to God.
Let us stand as we glory in the assurance of our pardon as we share together in the glory be to God on high. Glory be to God on high, and on earth peace, goodwill to all. We praise you, we bless you, we worship you, we glorify you, we give thanks to you for your great glory, O Lord God, Heavenly King, God the Father Almighty. O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, who take away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. You who take away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. You who take away the sin of the world, receive our prayer. You who sit at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For you only are holy, you prepare our hearts for the ministry of God's holy word, which comes to us from the book of Lamentations, chapter 1, reading verses 8 to 12. Jerusalem sinned grievously, so she has become a mockery. All who honored her despise her, for they have seen her nakedness, and she herself groans and turns her face away. Her uncleanness was in her skirts. She took no thought of her future. Her downfall was appalling, with none to comfort her. O Lord, look at my affliction, for the enemy has triumphed. Enemies have stretched out their hands over all her precious things. So she has even seen the nations invade her sanctuary, those whom you forbade to enter the congregation. All her people groan as they search for bread. They trade their treasures for food to revive their strength. Look, O Lord, and see how worthless I have become. Is it nothing to you, all you who pass by? Look and see if there is any sorrow like my sorrow, which was brought upon me, which the Lord inflicted on the day of his fierce anger. This is the word of the Lord. Our combined circuit choir will now minister to us in song, and after their rendition, Reverend Patmore Henry, Superintendent Minister of the St. Martin Circuit, will bring us the word.
Come to the table.
Let us pray. By your unerring spirit led, we shall not in the desert stray. We shall not full direction need, nor miss our providential way. As far from danger as from fear, why love, almighty love, is near. Providential God, breathe your spirit in us as we gather in this district council today. May you, O God, allow us to hear you speaking. And as we reflect one with another, may we be empowered to do your will. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Is it nothing to you? Lamentations chapter 1, verse 1 says, is it nothing to you, all you who pass by? Look and see if there is any sorrow like my sorrow, which was brought upon me, which the Lord inflicted on the day of his fierce anger. On encountering the devastation of 9/11, Philip Yancey asks the question, where is God when it hurts? And C.S. Lewis states that pain, the megaphone of God, rouses a deaf ear. The megaphone of pain announces a message of distress to all of humanity. It's time to re-examine life. The people of Israel knew why they were being punished, and a quick review of Lamentations context calls attention to the desolate state of the once thriving city of Jerusalem. The author imagines and personifies the sorrow of Jerusalem with that of a woman traumatized by grief. In her lament, she weeps bitterly as she looks at the devastating destruction of her beloved Jerusalem in 587 BC. And she invites the onlookers to share in her pain by asking the question, is it nothing to you? While Lamentations may not contain messianic prophecies, nor did the author envision the suffering church, I am suggesting to this district that it is necessary for our church to pause, reflect on our laments and the pain of our peoples who have been mentally, emotionally, and economically devastated by COVID-19 virus, have been devastated by the loss of jobs as a result of world economies' escalating costs, where some people are further impoverished and are now totally dependent on the state for their welfare. I quickly add, however, that these pains ought not be seen as the will of God, nor the punishment from God, but are as a result of the presence of sin in the world in which we live, for we are sinners. As we continue reflecting on the theme for the triennium, trust God in difficult times, transforming obstacles into opportunities, I am of the view that we need to lament the painful diminished situation that our church, which was once in the ascendancy, now finds itself in decline currently. Membership statistics indicate that in 2002, just this millennium, 18,756 was the membership. In 2005, 17,153. But by 2020, 13,356. If that is not a decline, If that does not deserve weeping, then what is? Therefore, to the district ministerial session, as we pass by the congregations, have we not seen the sparsely filled chapels? Is it nothing to us that when compared to the nascent years, the district is not thriving and is suffering from a form of spiritual anemia? Suffering from the prescriptive annual recommendations with no capacity to cure our Laodicean spirit. Have we not heard the laments caused by our paralysis of analysis? We spend more time in committees talking, but little or no action when we rise. Have we not heard members crying out for imaginative leadership? Have we not heard that some congregations and pastors are falling prey to every new liturgical format that appeases emotions? Have we not heard the groaning and sighs caused by leadership bereft of vision by our ministers, both local and itinerant? Is it nothing to you, district ministerial session? All who pass by Sunday after Sunday after Sunday? To the representative session, have we not heard the members crying in agonizing pain for their economic survival in these harsh economic times? And are asking, how much longer should the church tarry with an income-based offering with the offering plate? How much longer? Should not the matter of tithing be placed in the broader context of the stewardship of the church and the church's resources, especially in the context of our declining membership? Do we expect to get more out of less? If so, we are in serious crisis. To the stationing committee, is it nothing to you that doing missions while not producing ministers with an inherited itinerant system that does not meet the unique and diverse Caribbean island states context needs? Have we not seen, have we not heard of our situation as a church? Each year, we lament the declining membership. There is every evidence that the population explosion in our region is not reflected in the membership of our aging congregations. Is it possible that the itinerant system has contributed to the decline? I put it to you, reflect. And if you have to groan, please groan. It was the Reverend William Watty who said that in our churches, there are professional people dedicated as they are educated, capable and eager, yet we remain a minister-centered church. Everything is the parson. And we are still looking forward to rely upon the gathered congregation, the captive audience, and the pulpit ministry as our focus in these modern times. Unquote. Christian friends, are we satisfied in doing mission the same old way? Is it not true when he said, if you do the same old way, you'll get the same results? So therefore, we will not even be taking one step forward and two steps backward. We'll be taking all steps backward if we continue doing the same thing, the old, old way. Is the prophecy of Jeremiah our dilemma? We have eyes but do not see. We have ears but do not hear. Let us as a church listen to our youth and young adults as they share their pain as to how sometimes they feel abandoned by the church. We cannot move forward as a district if we fail to listen to the agonizing voices of our youth and young adults. Without them, how far can we go? These above mentioned laments ought to represent the agonizing pain we are experiencing in our district. What then is the message of hope for the people called Methodists in the MCCA? My brothers and sisters, even as we grieve over the present state of our church, I am persuaded that God has given each of us something that could be used for the advancement of the kingdom of God. I am persuaded that God has given each one something that could be used for the advancement of God. Do you believe this? Yes, my brothers and my sisters, sometimes we are overtaken by fear, anxiety, doubt, impatience, helplessness, and some thinks that it is a waste of time to try something new because the situation may not change. As a song reminds us, we just can't give up now. Some have said, while churches are turning the obstacle of COVID-19 protocols into opportunities for online worship, it has already increased the declining attendance at worship because live streaming for some is the new alternative to the gathered fellowship. I don't know your experience, but it looks like that. Some members have gotten comfortable staying at home, and they find all the reasons why they prefer to be home, turn on the device, and just worship with the people of God called Methodists from circuit to circuit, and in some cases, from district to district as well. Am I not talking the truth today? While some may lament, we cannot deny that the media ministry is a mission opportunity that must continue. The use of technology and indeed digitizing data along with the use of social media platforms are necessary for a church serving the present age. Am I hearing an amen? Once this digital ministry is properly planned and executed, one day we will reap the fruits. Am I in? Furthermore, we must commend our young adults for their commitment towards establishing the district website. When this is fully utilized, the opportunities will transform the connecting capabilities of congregation with congregation, the district with the connection. Indeed, it will. In fact, is it not commendable that our Zoom platform has not only facilitated connection with a low cost to the district, especially for our district meetings, but also provided a space with opportunities for spiritual growth, such as Bible studies, such as counseling, and such as worship. These are necessary for the growth and the advancement of the kingdom of God in the 21st century. Christian friends, central to the church's mission, whether virtually or in person, is the unchanging gospel message that Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus saves, and God is our comforter in any crisis. Come on, somebody. God invites us in every situation to have fellowship with him. Have we not heard that the Holy Communion liturgy, yes, God in it is inviting us to a life of holiness? The very liturgy itself is a call to holiness. Whether online or in person, it's a call to holiness. How do we, the church, think about God or link God is how truly our mission is advanced. So, as we think and understand our God, our mission then cannot be anything else but to spread scriptural holiness in our homes, in our churches, in our communities. Yes, indeed, as we say, in the land. But that depends on how you think about your God. Also, I wish to share, God is a faithful God. God is faithful to his promises. Our evangelism ministry must emphasize that there is life beyond the pandemic, because God is faithful. He will never leave us nor forsake us. He will be with us to the end. And if God is for us, hallelujah, who can be against us? Praise the Lord, somebody. That there is hope for future. There is hope for future in the financial crisis. God does not depend on our money or financial capacity to be the Jehovah Jireh. God alone stands as Jehovah Jireh, with our money or without our money. Come somebody, praise God. The Bible says, look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap, nor store away in barns. And yet, your Heavenly Father, indeed, our Heavenly Father, feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? He asks. Matthew chapter 6, verse 26. My brothers and sisters, we have a mission. As a church, indeed, we have a mission to help people to adjust their lives and livelihoods in this new normal, in this new way. We have a mission given unto us. This is an opportunity to turn obstacles into opportunities. We also have a counseling opportunity to help people to cope with the anxiety and stress they are experiencing. There is need to have an enabling or support ministry giving spiritual direction, guidance, and listen to this, and financial guidance and support. We have an opportunity to train people to be innovative. Any church which is actively involved in the daily life of the people in the community will thrive. So if we are not thriving, then therefore it means we are not active in the community. Come on, somebody. For years, we have agonized as to how we can increase our membership. Is it not time to invite people to become Christians, rather than inviting them just to come to church? Is it not time to invite people to confront themselves in their relationship with God, that they be converted, having encountered God? That is then that each of us will see ourselves as evangelists. Each of us will see ourselves as missionaries. Each of us will see ourselves speaking to people on a one-on-one in our daily lives, inviting them to have a relationship with God. Come on, church. Is it not time for us, rather than saying, I'm inviting you to church, invite them to meet God, to become Christians. Hallelujah. Joining a church ought to be an outward reflection of an inward love. Come on, somebody. Joining a church, any church, is an outward reflection of the inward love of Christ and the love of Christ in you to share with somebody else. Hallelujah. Praise God, church. Love for God and love for neighbor. Is it not time to embrace the ordinary person in the street? Becoming a church without walls, not being comfortable in the four walls of the church. I ask the question, how often do we leave the four walls and go witnessing in the community? Once per year, maybe now and then? Perhaps that is what is contributing to our decline, because we have failed to be the witnessing church and the witnessing community. Yes, my friends, people need the Lord. A song reminds us, on they go through private pain, living fear to fear. Laughter hides their silent cries, only Jesus hears. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, people need the Lord. He's the open door. Yes, church, that is the purpose for which we exist, to help people to understand that they need the Lord. When will we realize people need the Lord? Lastly, colleagues, if we are not equipped in this age of online education, we have an opportunity given unto us to equip ourselves with the tools that make us better equipped to do mission. Come on, somebody. There is no need to lament or to find excuses anymore. You can stay right in your study. You can stay right in your desk to do a particular study to equip oneself. And as you do that study, you can also pass that study on to your membership in your congregation, equipping the laity to do mission as well. We must move from this minister-centered church and see the work of God is everybody's business. Are you with me, church? Mission, in which involves the transformation of people's lives. Mission that utilizes the resources of the church for productive, sustainable development. Mission that enables people to make a living. Mission with bold initiative that build for a better church. This is why there is need for a human resource department in the district. That is most needed, because continuous professional development and human resource management are paramount to turning obstacles into possibilities in this church in the 21st century. Are you with me, church? My fellow servants of Christ, whatever are the obstacles, however diminished the church may be, let us collectively and individually repent. Repent acknowledging our failures. Repent acknowledging our contribution, for each of us has contributed to the present situation, the present state of the church. Don't look at the other person and say, it's not me. All of us have done something to make the church where it is. The time has come for us as a district. The time has come for us as circuits. The time has come for us as congregation to repent. For without repentance, there will be no change. Repent. For we all should be lamenting on the state of affairs. Also, let us realize that the presence and power of God's Holy Spirit is within and with us. Oh, hallelujah. I have no doubt that the Holy Spirit is alive in the Methodist Church in the Caribbean Americas, is alive in the Leeward Islands District, is alive with us today, even as we gather on this platform for worship. God's Spirit is making it happen. And God's Holy Spirit is more than able to help us transform the situational obstacles into mission opportunities for the renewal of His church. Are you available, or is it nothing to you? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. O God, our Father, truly, you are our captain, and with you, we shall not in the desert stray. So continue to speak to us as we lament in the pain that we have experienced and are experiencing, so we will know that you are still calling us as a church to turn our obstacles into opportunities. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen and amen. And now, in response to the word, I invite us to sing the hymn 455, I the Lord of Air and Sky.
I'm in the Apostles' Creed as printed. Together, we believe in one God, the Father of men,
creator of heaven and earth, and all that is in our sin. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us human beings and for salvation. He came down from heaven, by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became one of from the Virgin Mary, and was born a human being. For our sake, he was crucified on the Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. And on the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scripture. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, and who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in the one holy, Catholic, and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated. And this was the Nicene Creed. Let us now prepare our hearts to partake of the Lord's Supper. As we sing together the hymn, The Sign of Love. Number 429 in the voice.
Thank you.
We are the body of Christ.
In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us therefore keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God.
It is right and fitting to do.
It is a good and pleasant thing, joyful and salutary, always and everywhere to give you thanks and praise, Lord God, ever living, ever blessed, almighty, all loving, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, you created all things and made us in your image. And when we had fallen into sin, you gave him to be our Savior. He shared our human nature and lived a fully human life. He suffered rejection and condemnation and died on the cross. You raised him up from the dead, and you exalted him to the glory of your right hand, where he reigns forever as priest and king and makes intercession for us. In witness of his glory and honor, you poured out the Holy Spirit, building up many people into one body, making us living members of your holy church, and enabling us to stand before you to sing your praises and to celebrate your mighty acts. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we join in the hymn of everlasting praise.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, Lord God, King of the universe, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread into his holy hands and, looking up to heaven, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this and eat it. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me."
Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Therefore, Father, in obedience to his command, we do this in remembrance of him, praying that you will accept our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Grant that, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we who receive your gifts of bread and wine may share in the body and blood of Christ and become united with him. And as we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice, we pray that you will bring us with your whole creation to your heavenly kingdom. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord,
to whom with you, O Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory of all who dwell on earth and in heaven, throughout the ages of ages. Amen.
The bread which we break is the sharing in the body of Christ.
Amen.
The cup of blessing which we bless is the sharing in the blood of Christ.
Amen. Though we are many, we are one body, because we share the one loaf and partake of the same drink.
Kindly be seated as we continue to prepare ourselves in silent prayer to come to the Lord's table. Let us pray in silence. And now together, the prayer of humble access. Lord, we come to your table, trusting in your mercy, and not in any goodness of our own. We are not worthy to gather the crumbs under your table,
but it is your nature always to have mercy, and on that we depend. So feed us with the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him, and he in us. Amen. You who truly and sincerely repent of your sins, are in love and charity with your neighbors, and have resolved to lead a new life following the commandments of God, and by the power of the Spirit walking in his holy ways, draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, and his blood which was shed for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ is broken for us to keep us unto eternal life. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is shed for you to keep you in eternal life. Take and drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. Let us together give thanks. We thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet prepared for all mankind. Amen. We join in chanting the Lord's Prayer. Closing hymn,
is 381. Lord, dismiss us with your blessing.
And also with you.
Depart in peace.